Es tut mir leid, ich kann nicht in Deutsch sprechen. Mein Schwiegervater war in München geboren und die Eltern meiner Schwiegermutter waren in Vorpommern geboren. Aber ich kann nicht gut Englisch sprechen, ich bin Schottisch. England ist eine Kolonie von Schottland. Ich bin ein Beamter, pobre Inglese, need to look me after. So, what I'm going to do is speak to you just as though you were people running hospitals in England, because the problems are the same. Bureaucracy is different, but the problems are the same. So, Austria sounds complex, but there are some simple issues. And the role of leadership is to change culture. Management works within the culture, but leadership, and you are the leaders of the health, not the ministers, you are the leaders of healthcare in Austria. So we need to change how people think. And part of this is about language. The word Wert is a difficult word, but my hero is Wittgenstein, so here we are in the city of Wittgenstein. And also, what has influenced me a lot in the last few years is the new research that we change the way people's brains work. Your job is to change how people think. Not what they think, but how they think. And like me, many of you were taught from Cajal that we were born with a certain number of brain cells, and then it was... But we now know that you can form new networks at any age. So, thinking differently. I would not be saying this to my audience in England, but because I'm going to now speak as though you are a group of people very busy, not enough money, too much pressure, and I'm going to tell you what the future will be like. So, this is the future. Need and demand will increase 10-20%, and resources will not increase. And by resources, I mean much more than money. So I mean, and clinicians are more concerned about, about to be in the right position. Clinicians are much more concerned about time than money. We also find that clinicians are much more concerned about carbon. And all our hospitals have a carbon footprint. I don't know if you have this here. And on the frontline staff, you say, oh, this hospital's in financial difficulty. And the staff say, yeah, look at the idiots who are running it, who are usually standing beside me. But you speak to staff about carbon. Oh, yes, my children are worried about carbon. So we have a Centre for Sustainable Healthcare. And I won't speak about that today, but 80% of the carbon is caused by doctors. Only 20% is heating and lighting. 20% is staff and patient travel, and 60% is the carbon in drugs and MRI machines and the like. So it's clinical practice that causes carbon, not heating and lighting. So to you clinicians, I say to them, if you care about carbon, climate change. So this is the future. Now, if we, there are four factors driving this increase in needed demand. So firstly, demographic change, obviously population aging. We can do something about that. I believe that dementia can be prevented by about 20% by keeping people active. And that is the other half of my life, is reducing dementia and frailty. But these next things here, so what we're seeing is inevitable, the development of new effective interventions. And this is what happened to new oral anticoagulants in England. I'm sure the same has happened here. So we are now spending £500 million a year on new oral anticoagulants. And no one actually made that decision. There was a guidance came out saying, yes, there is evidence that it is effective. But not one warfarin clinic has been closed. So the problem is new interventions without closing the old services that should stop. So population aging, and then the development of new effective interventions. And then what David Eddy called in 1993, the relentless increase in the volume and intensity of clinical practice. So here's what's happened in England to lab testing, laboratory testing. And it increased threefold between 2000 and 2015. Do you have any data? Is it this similar to Austria? Yeah. Now, interestingly here, you can see this means that the average general practitioner is now spending 70 minutes a day looking at computer screens. And we worked out this is 4,924 GPs. So our Minister of Health said there will be 5,000 new GPs. Well, they're all looking at computer screens. Completely. Now, all these lab tests are of high quality. You know, the lab people are very good at, you know, ISO standard this and ISO standard that. Very efficient. We now do more tests. Every blood sample is tested, 10, 20. But what is the value of this? So, population aging, new interventions. Now, this here is something which is, we'll come back to this, how we manage this. Thinking a little bit about the past, we've had two revolutions in healthcare. And the first revolution was the public health revolution. And this picture you'll recognize is the water supply for Vienna. And then the last 50 years, we've had the second revolution, my time in medicine. It's been fantastic what's happened in the last 50 years. And I just put up some of the advances there. And we're now in the third revolution. And Manuel Castells writes and says, the third revolution is driven by three forces: citizens, knowledge, and this. This is much more influential than the human genome. My colleagues in Oxford don't like me saying it, but I think they agree. I'm not sure about big data, artificial intelligence, genomics, but this is changing what is happening. So the second revolution, people like you were very, very important because you could control what was happening in the hospital. But now it's like Uber, Airbnb, what's going on out there? And my question to hospital chief executives in England is, are you in the real estate business or the knowledge business? I know you've got real estate to manage, but actually what's going on out there is this. So how do we compete with this? How does the London taxi compete with Uber? Very similar issues in healthcare. So let's think a little bit about what we can learn from the past. Well, the trouble, when we look, we see in England that although we've done these fantastic things here and contributed to the decline in mortality and the decline in disability, we see, as I see in every country, three big problems. And the first of these is what Jack Venberg called unwarranted variation. That's variation that cannot be explained. So if you look at hospital-based data, we know that a high rate of admission to stroke units is good, and a low rate of admission is not good. We know that a low rate of hip redo operations is good, and a high is bad. But here's examples. This is on the left-hand side here. This is the percentage of people dying in hospital in England, and it varies from 75% to 45%. What is right? I do not know. What do you think is right for your population? On the right-hand side is CT colonoscopy. Now these are data produced using the population as the denominator, not the hospital. This is what Jack Venberg did. And we produced NHS atlases of variation. And we produce these to destabilise the medical profession. Because the medical profession thinks, well, it's all doing evidence-based medicine, and you know, it's all just need more money. But then you look at this for CT colonoscopy, you know, what are you guys actually doing? What have you decided? What do you think? Why is yours? Do you know who you are on this table? No, I don't know. But it's all high quality. Yeah. Yes, but we're very good. We've got a new MRI machine. I met a friend who's a chief exec of a hospital. He says we'll need to buy a new MRI machine every 3 years. Some of you are nodding. I can see it's all wonderful quality and everything is busy and doing things. But what is so unwanted variation? Is there an atlas of variation produced in Austria? It's called the Venberg collaboration. So, but this is to destabilize the medical profession. Because for a revolution, you have to destabilize before you can start. And the unwanted variation shows two problems. And one of these is underuse, combined with inequity. So these are data from England showing that people from the poorest part of society get about a third of the rate of hip and knee replacement from people in the wealthiest part of society. This is the NHS. This is not private practice. This is the NHS. And we would show this, almost everything we look at, poor people get less healthcare than wealthy people. I don't know if you have data here and these sorts of issues. So unwanted variation shows underuse and it shows overuse. So here's variation in hip replacement in England by population. I'm not sure what population base you would use in Austria, like the Länder or within the Länder, the smaller populations. And you can see here, there's a fourfold variation in the rate of hip replacement. So what is right? What is right for your population or your population? Because if you've been doing a lot of hip replacement for the last 10 years, then it might be right to have a low level. This is part of the discussion. I'm going to show you what I think is the most important picture in healthcare. It's not this one, it's coming soon. And I usually say to the young people in the audience, get your phone out now for this. There's a young person there with his phone out. I want you all to photograph this and to tweet it, and coming soon. So this is Avedis Donabedian, who invented quality assurance in 1966. And Donabedian pointed out that as you increase investment, then the benefits increase and then they flatten off. So once in a lifetime cervical smear, 10-year interval, 5-year interval, 3-year interval, 1-year interval. It's called in English the law of diminishing returns. The trouble with healthcare is the more healthcare we do, the more harm we do. This is not the harm due to errors, this is all healthcare does harm. Radiation, drugs, operation, burden. And at this stage, I'd be saying in England that if we were in Graz, is the editor of the Graz newspaper here? What's the Graz newspaper, Roman?
Kleine Zeitung.
What?
Kleine Zeitung.
Is the editor of the Kleine Zeitung here? Because he or she needs to start publishing this. All they publish at the moment are pictures of a new MRI unit. Linz. What's the newspaper in Linz? They publish the new MRI unit or some bad thing that's happened, blaming the chief exec. But they need to publish this. All healthcare does harm. It's all wonderful, but it does have inevitable. And pediatrician not in there. We have to understand this. So what Donabedian did was he did that. He subtracted harm from benefit and got it. This is the most important picture in healthcare. This has to appear in the Climate Zeitung next week. What did you say in the newspaper? Yeah, you need to send me one. I want one with this picture. And this, I would be doing this. I'd be doing exactly this if I was in the town hall in Linz or Graz. I now say to the public, now turn to your neighbour and tell me where you think we've gone beyond the point of optimality in Linz or Graz. Okay, so now turn to your neighbour and just think about Austria and have a couple of minutes discussion in German about overuse, where we've gone beyond the point of optimality. Okay? Introduce yourself to your neighbour if you don't know one another, and let's have a couple of minutes talking about overuse, starting now. Let's take some examples in German, if you wish, of overuse. Anyone like to volunteer? Otherwise, I just point to people.
Just discuss the written person question is how to determine the point of optimality.
Yes.
We certainly know that in Austria, probably on the overuse side.
Yes.
How much can we do services to get to the point of optimality and not to result in underuse?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. That's it. We'll come back to that. Do you have examples of overuse? Anyone going to, yes?
Barbara Meyer, gynecologist and obstetrician. Cesarean section.
Cesarean section, yes.
Austria, yes.
Yep.
It's very dependent upon, not so much perinatal centers, but depending on where the birth giving takes place.
Yes, yes. Many reasons for it, but cesarean section. Other things that come up? Yes.
I would be interested in if you have any data lying.
Yes, well, yes, there are plenty of data. We'll show you some data from Australia. But what examples are you thinking of? What interventions?
I would like to see if there's any if you could clarify where hips would be very interesting.
Hips, yeah. Okay. Anything else?
Also imaging.
Imaging.
So you do a lot of it. And it is given by the reports in the media.
Yeah.
No sign of pain like in the UK and state and Russia, but to be recognition.
Yeah.
I see that now before the baby is the companion.
Yes. So lab sign. Testing, imaging, hips.
Sorry? And PDAs and RBCs.
Yes, yeah.
Intervention for those.
Stents, epidemic of stents sometimes happens, yes. Anything else?
Basic question probably is if you know where you derive your point of overuse from.
Yes.
If you derive it from the guidelines and the indication, the indication quality is an issue.
Yeah.
So you have to define overuse first before we talk about it.
Yeah, it's a matter of judgment though. It's a matter of judgment.
Yeah, but it's very individual sometimes.
Yes, but individual clinicians cannot see it because they're so close. Every clinician thinks they're doing the right thing.
Yeah, but then you have to define overuse first, because otherwise you can say we...
Overuse is the use of resources that would get more value if they were used in another group of people. So we're starting to think... I never mention the word savings to clinicians. They're not interested in savings. But you're looking for things that people want to do more of. So if you want to do more treatment of rheumatoid arthritis, then you have to look at shoulder surgery, back surgery, and knee surgery. And then maybe overuse here in comparison in your local population with that. Yes?
Well, in Austria, it's maybe the general inpatient setting as compared to the outpatient setting.
Yes? Yeah.
So I believe that most clinicians that work in the inpatient setting think that registering patient in the hospital is generally a good idea.
Yeah.
And that results in much downstream issues and many downstream issues. Resulting in cost, harm, etc.
Yeah.
That maybe would not have to be dealt with in the outpatient setting.
But I'll show you what comes up in England for about overuse. At this deal. The medicals of the last 50 years are now entering into the overuse. Chemotherapy always comes up in England. Not either from the public, but from doctors. A doctor said to me in Oxford, my job is to protect people from too much oncology. And then you say, it comes up in the public, and I say, no, I'm not saying no to a ninth round of chemotherapy. If you really, really want to stay alive for 3 weeks to see a granddaughter born, we will do everything. But do the patients know what the risks and benefits are? And the answer is, not always. So all these things here are overused. What also comes up in England is end of life in the public. And it's partly, my mother was admitted to hospital. They were very nice, but you know, she finished up in ITU. And she died in ITU and she wanted to die at home. So certainly, I think a recognition for older people with multi-morbidity, in England we call it the deconditioning syndrome. You know, people just go downhill like that if they're admitted. And that's one of the things that we do is saying, well, we need more nurses, community nurses. So we have to try and switch resources from the hospital sector to the community nursing. Otherwise, someone phones the ambulance and the person's in E&E. Yes?
But still, if we talk about overusing, you said the problem is value, additional value, and you switch resources to nurses. The most important thing is, I think, communication.
Yes.
The value point can only be identified by the patient then.
Yes, we'll come back. Good point. Yeah, we'll come back to that. I'm going to get. Value is a very difficult word. I wish we had Wittgenstein here, but there we are. We're going to discuss value.
We wouldn't talk if we had Wittgenstein.
Okay, so this is the most important picture in health. So let's just think about what we're going to do. Now, we've done four things in the last 30 years, but very well, very important, as well as the technology and everything. The four things are prevention. We've done quite well in prevention. Secondly, evidence-based decision-making. It's now about 1995. We set up the Centre for Evidence-Based Medicine in Oxford. So now it's pretty standard. Evidence of cost-effectiveness. Cochrane was about the same time. We set up the two initiatives there. Firstly, organising the knowledge, and secondly, bringing the knowledge into decision-making. Thirdly, quality improvement, very, very important. Oh, I was going to ask you, Roland, to just show the, can you show the polypharmacy data?
Yeah, we had in the discussion, we had
stand up for
the overuse discussion. And we just experienced in Austria, we have in the new Ökotet, we have the variation of polypharmacy in elderly people, more than 70 years. And you see a manifold variation between, let's say, Vorarlberg and Burgenland. Nobody knows why in polypharmacy. So that was our example too. That we have enough numbers and figures to prove that we have variation, unwarranted variation.
That comes up with the public too. If it's a public meeting in England, oh, my mother's on 12 drugs. Are they really all doing it good? Or? She mixes them up. So polypharmacy is another example. There's some people undoubtedly need. I'm on 8 different drugs. I had a heart attack and various other problems. But you know, what's the value of them all? So there's an example. So these are the four things we've done. And quality improvement is very, very important. Productivity and efficiency, I'll come back to the difference between efficiency and value. So we've done these things, but while we'll be doing these things, unwarranted variation, overuse, and inequity have either persisted or developed or got worse. So these are necessary, but not sufficient. That's an English phrase. Does that translate well? Necessary, but not sufficient. So these are absolutely, you must carry on. These are the Fab Four, like the Beatles, okay? So we have to carry on to the Fab Four. But the move now is to focus on value. Now, English is a very difficult language. And Oxford is the headquarters of the English language. The Oxford English Dictionary is produced. And it is our business. And Oxford is also very big in linguistic philosophy. So let's just think a little bit about the meanings of the word value. And value translates quite well. I remember when we introduced evidence-based medicine, we had the first meeting on evidence-based medicine in the Charité. And Dave Sackett and I, we were in the pathology museum there, you know, with all the fetuses and bottles and everything, having a reception in the evening. And these young doctors called me over and they said, we have a problem, a big problem. So what's the problem? They tell evidence-based medicine. Because evidence in German does not mean not requiring proof. It does in English too. It's evident I was not born in Oxford. So Dave and I said, well, we don't care what you call it. What would you like to call it? And the young doctor said, well, we're discussing calling it kritische Medizin, critical medicine. We're going to be critical of the knowledge. We said, that's fine, yeah, we really call it that. And the young doctor said, no, we will change the German language. And there was silence in the museum. So evidence doesn't translate very well. I find the word value translates quite well. Now, in English, the word values in the plural means principles. The values of Oxford University Hospital are compassion and clinical excellence. Now, the word value in the singular has more of an economic meaning. Worth is another translation. Of course, worth and debt, very similar. So now I'd like to spend some time with your neighbor. If I say value is the most important word for people like you in the next 10 years, what are the meanings of the word value that are buzzing about in your head? Value in healthcare. Okay, so just spend 2 or 3 minutes discussing with your neighbor now. Okay, let's take some feedback, can we? Yes.
So the word value in German is Wert ist Zahl und Wert. So Wert, wenn there's Werte, Wert und Werte-basierte Medizin.
Ja.
Wert für die Zahl.
Yes.
Man sagt, da ziehe ich die Evidenz her, 325,
ja.
25 patients, at this and that, and the result was this. And Werte is for the principles.
Yes, yeah, sure, good. Yes, yeah, so there is a difference.
As an example. Wert and Werte.
Yes, yeah, sure. The issue is, do you feel that lovely jacket you're wearing was good value?
I like it.
Yeah, okay, so personal, there's a personal view.
There's a value and Wert und Werte.
In almost every country, people do this with the word value. Farmers and so there's something. So value is subjective. This is the first point. Quality is objective. Percentage of people admitted to a stroke unit. But everyone having a hip replacement may have a different. Okay, other comments on value? Yes?
I think there are two main meanings of this term. First is value, just as we discussed it,
yes.
Benefit for
outcome, yes.
Yeah. And the other is ethical values.
Yes.
Is the benefit of the patient really our most important principle?
Yep.
Are they really working for the benefit of the patient, or are we forced to hope economic outcomes, which are important in many systems, on top?
So the hospital chief executive may have a different definition of value. In England, if people have a what we call a tariff, it's of high value. The hospital admission is high value,
right.
And the chief executive is unhappy with doctors who try to reduce referral. So there may be there's an individual version of value, then there's an institutional version of value, yes?
And this is the core of the whole problem, I think, in healthcare. Because most, and if you look at the doctors, most doctors get into healthcare with an ethical type of value.
Yes.
And then it's changed to an economical type.
Yeah.
And so we lose our values
yes.
as doctors.
and we are pressed to accept the economical value of a human, so to say, of the system.
Yeah.
And that's the point where the disintegration of doctors starts from the system, the internal immigration, the devaluation.
Yeah.
And then if we are detached from the system, then the big failure mode starts.
Yeah. I'll come back, a very good analysis there. We'll come back to the culture. Yep. At the back, the obstetrician.
I would suggest, let's face it, value is an open context term.
Yes.
We have to reduce the term value to a very concrete situation.
Yep.
What does it mean in this specific situation?
Yes.
The question arises for whom?
Yes.
And the question arises, what are the consequences if we apply this in a concrete situation?
Yeah. So this is complex. But remember, healthcare is the most complex business on earth. It's more complex than war. Running an airline is easy compared to running healthcare. Running a car factory is easy. It's very good. I've learned a lot from Toyota. I'll mention Toyota. But it's dead simple. But you guys have radiation and patients and the kleine Zeitung, politics, lawyers, everything going on. So let me tell you the way we are using the word value, and this is also in which we'll distribute. This is the new report from the European Union on value, value-based healthcare, and there are four different aspects of value. There's obviously a multitude, because every individual has their own value. But so here's the four aspects of value, and I'll go through these one by one. Personal value for the individual, technical value in your hospital, population value in the land of Niederösterreich or for Austria, and then social value. Now, another important word is waste. And this is very Toyota. Waste is not just what goes in the waste bin. It is anything that does not add value. You've heard of the word Kaizen and Muda. Have you heard of Muda? Muda, waste. Taichi Ono hated waste. There's another very good word, Japanese word, a student taught me called Motainai. And Motainai is a feeling of remorse for having wasted resources.
Shouldn't have ordered that MRI. Why did I order that MRI?
Oh,
no, I don't see much of that.
So that's Modainai. How would you translate waste, Roland and German? What would be the best word for waste? Verschwendung. So start to think now. We're getting into how you change the way all your doctors think in the hospital. So let's look at these. Firstly, personal value. And this is, so evidence-based decision-making, the evidence is designed on groups of patients, randomized controlled trials, but how does it relate to this individual, to their particular problem, and to the other problems they have? And I think the key issue here is elective surgery. And I find in England, most doctors stay away from having hip replacement and knee replacement. Even if they could pick the best doctor, the best surgeon, they go, oh, no, thank you very much, I'll just wait. So here's an example of a good consultation. A friend of mine, professor of knee surgery in Oxford, a woman comes in and he says, what can I do for you? And the woman says, I need a knee replacement. And he said, what is bothering you? And she said, well, I love gardening, but I'm having trouble bending. And he said, do you understand that if I replace your knee, you might not be able to kneel at all? I'm very good, a good operation, but you might not be able to kneel at all. She said, thank you very much, and went out. Now, whether she went for long-handled gardening tools or raised flower beds, you know, that's up to her. But she knew then about the probability. And I'm saying in England, I don't think we should pay for any elective operation unless we've really found out what's really bothering the individual, not their x-ray, but what's bothering them. And we measure afterwards, since we did the treatment, Is what's bothering, was bothering you better, no better, no worse? And we're not gathering 100% of people will be better. You have to accept that. So start to think in different ways about personal value. Now the second type of value is the value in your hospital or in your land. And here, two important terms, one's productivity, and the other's efficiency. And these are standard economic terms. Productivity is outputs over inputs, average duration of stay, for example. But efficiency is outcomes over inputs. So that's the percentage of people who have a good outcome related to the resources. Now this is what the Americans call value, because the Americans don't have to worry about the whole population. So all the articles on value in America, in JAMA and New England Journal, are all about efficiency. But you, in Austria, or yes, you?
I just want to clarify, or ask you to clarify between output and outcome.
Output is just number of operations done.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Yeah.
And efficiency only comes then with value.
Yeah, if efficiency
in terms of personal value.
Yes, but it's part of the value of the use of resources in the land. So efficiency is part of value. It's one of the four aspects of value. Now we'll come on to what makes it different in Austria and the United States. So what we are interested in a country committed to universal health coverage is also the services for the whole population. Remember the graph I showed you about inequity, hip and knee replacement? So I don't know if this occurs now, but increasingly, we are saying to the hospital chief executive, who would then say to his orthopedic department, and I'm pointing to a hospital chief executive here, do you know, are there as many people, who's getting to the specialist service? You see, broken legs, if I get run down out there, or outside my hotel, I don't need to worry about getting to the right hospital, you know. If I have a huge heart attack, I'll get to the right place. But most of healthcare is more complex than that. So what we are doing now is start to think about, let's take something, it's not too simple, but I've never heard it discussed, skin disease. So we spend £2 billion a year on skin disease. Is he a dermatologist?
Okay.
Okay. Well, let's put a bit of pressure. But if you go into a psoriasis clinic, how do the people get there? On the bus. But what we know is it'll be the middle class people who will be getting the psoriasis clinic. In some way, always the wealthy people. But your knowledge in your head, what we want you to do is to come up with this. So you need to influence. I'm pointing at this poor chap here. Where do you work? Yeah. So start to think within the dermatology department there, one of the dermatologists, even half a day a week, would have a map on the wall and be saying, well, I wonder why we're getting more referrals from there. I wonder how many new family medicine doctors came to work in our population. What do they know about psoriasis and what we think about psoriasis? I wonder how many pharmacists there are dotted about the hospital. So population dermatology. Now you still have to have quality dermatology, but this is population dermatology. You there start to look at variations in referral and do things in different ways. And you see here, this is where the quality issue, quality improvement reduces harm a little bit and improves benefit a little bit, but it doesn't actually change the shape of things. So we need to think, we must keep going on prevention, evidence-based decision-making, quality improvement, and productivity, but then we've got to think about value as well. Now, the come on to population value, and this is the way we spend the money in England, and it's service line accounting. And I was looking as I walked along the corridor here, I mean, it's every country in the world, you see the same thing. Now, who makes decisions in Austria about this? In England, it's quite hard to find. I know who should be making the decision. It's what we call our population health boards. But this is very difficult. They find this very difficult. And actually, there's no formula that can do this. Ken Arrow got the Nobel Prize for his impossibility theorem. So big data can't do this. And there's no single ethical principle either. We just have to get a group of people in the room and lock the door. And if the public want to be involved, they can be involved, because it's bloody difficult. Because every time you switch resources, some group will suffer. This second level, this is the clinicians have to take responsibility for this second level. Because what you see in England, and I'm sure in Austria, you go to one hospital and it's a really good asthma service, and you go 10 miles down the road and the hospital there has got a really good bronchitis service. Why? Because there's a really good asthma doctor, you know, very good at working the system and doing things, or it's medical politics. You know, how they screw the chief exec of the hospital and how they get more staff appointed to their subspecialty. And they don't think, they're not worried about them with the expenditure or anything. They're committed, passionately committed to their specialty, and that's a good thing. So this is allocative population value. And of course, what's always overlooked, and I don't know if it's the same in Austria, the biggest single spend is mental health. If you ask an audience in England how much is spent in mental health, they'll probably say £10 million, and then I do that. How much is spent in mental health in Austria? It's the biggest single budget, biggest single spend. And that's not counting people with mental health problems in gastroenterology or pediatrics or whatever. I mean, that's another spend to mental health. Because it's separate services. You're not responsible for mental health, are you, Linz? The mental health services? Oh, you are. So we've, in general, got separate mental health organizations. And then the last type of value is social value.
What are the numbers for oncology?
Sorry?
What are the numbers for oncology?
Oncology is about 100 million too. Oncology and cardio are two big ones. You see, even eyes and vision is 30 million. Skin is about 20 million. It's big money. Yeah. These people are the clinicians, but the clinicians still are getting there. But that means we have to start thinking of the job description. There's no way that I, as a sort of public health policymaker, can make decisions about skin disease. I need a dermatologist to take responsibility for this and recognize that in their job description, how we do. And then this last social value is it's in some sense a very simple concept. Let me give you an example of social value. The Centre for Sustainable Healthcare we set up at Oxford, we were working with a hospital in Cornwall, and this was about supply of food. And the local farmers had a cooperative, and you know, they made a tender, European Union rules, of course. But the contract went to some multinational bringing in frozen food from Poland, because it was cheaper, you know, and you've got to give the contract to the lowest tender. But you don't have to give the contract to the lowest tender. I mean, what the hospital could have done was to say, well, we'll give, you know, we appreciate a little bit more cost in the short term, but we're supporting jobs in the local economy. And that might mean that the children of the farmers stay at home and come to our nursing school. You know, there's the benefits of the environmental benefits, social environmental benefits. So, okay. Now, so we're in the most complex business on earth. Now, let's move on just to finish about how do we get there. So, we've got to do carry on with the Fab Four: prevention, evidence-based decision making, quality improvement, cost reduction. Now here's the new things that we're looking at and introducing. So number one, the culture, the job of leadership is to change culture. And this sense of collective responsibility. And of course, what we do all the time is we fiddle with the structure of the health service in England. I've had over 20 reorganizations in my time, most of which have made no difference at all. Change the structure. Politicians love changing structure. But it doesn't actually make much difference. What is important are systems and culture. So we need to move from this to this. So, see, who feels responsible for this? I can't find anyone who feels responsible. Is it the British Cardiac Society or the Director of Finance for the NHS? Or it just so happened, you know? We just spent £500 million in 5 years without having, we don't feel responsible. What do people feel about this? The lab people feel any responsibility? You just keep slipping in extra tests. I fell and broke some ribs. I suffer from a disorder called stupidity, so I tripped and broke some ribs. And then I was told I might have borderline osteopenia. And then I had a blood test. And they didn't know, you know, I'm a silent shopper, they don't know my job. And then I got a letter saying I'll get NGUS. Do you know what NGUS is? Monogammaglobulinemia of unknown significance. Of unknown significance. And I got a referral to the hematology clinic. And the hematology clinic can't afford to buy bloody drugs for leukemia, yet it's saying, well, what do the lab people think they're up to? Any lab people here? Yeah. All very high quality, all very low cost, but you know. But what do the GPs think they're up to? Why do they carry on ordering these things? And what does the Hofbeamte and the land think? Do they ever think about this? Presumably you get paid for all these lab tests, send a bill in somewhere and get paid. So, when you change culture is a job of leadership. So, there are different things you can do. One, and the home of Wittgenstein, is introduce a new language. So here's the language: system, network, pathway, program, value, optimality. And there's also words, they're hidden up there. I try to ban the word manager. Why do I not like the word manager? Allows clinicians to hate the manager. We used to talk about people who manage. That's all of you. You know, if you were all the clinicians in your office, you're all managing resources. Oh, I'm not a manager, no. Do you ever order an MRI? Yes or yes? No. You're managing resources, people who manage. And this concept of stewardship has come back into English with the climate change. We are the stewards of the planet. Stewardship is to care for something you don't own for future generations. What word's been used in German, Roland?
Hirte. Jemand who takes care of the sheep, the herd.
Yeah.
Hirte.
But it's very interesting because in German there is not a specific term for stewardship, which tells something about our mindset. Yeah.
But I haven't looked this up. How is the parable of the good steward told in the Bible? What term is used? Is it shepherd?
Yeah.
Shepherd.
Yes.
And because it's interesting, shepherd, this is, the economics of this is called the tragedy of the commons. And Eleanor Ostrom got the Nobel Prize that if you've got common land or common fishery, it has to be the shepherds taking responsibility. You can't bring in Deloitte or someone else to manage it, because the shepherds will always find a way to fool external management. You can't privatize it. It's commons, the law of the commons is what we do. So it's stewardship. So getting rid of the fuel, because if we waste resources, it's other patients who suffer. It's not the taxpayer. I don't give a damn about the taxpayer. It's other patients. And our Academy of Medical Royal Colleges produced a very good report on this, which I'll send you for circulation. And they said that there's the duty of a clinician not to waste resources, because if you waste resources, it's some other patient who will suffer. Their treatment will be delayed or may not be delivered at all. But we've never said that before in England. We're at quite an early stage of this, but it's changing culture. Okay, so concept of stewardship. In some countries, they're just using the word stewardship. Interestingly, the Quran has a similar concept in it, with a similar sort of wording. And this was part of the Reformation, of course, was, you know, I'm not religious in a formal sense, but we're on earth and we're given responsibilities, not just to use the resources. Okay, number two, population subgroups. Now, this is the way we've run healthcare in the past. So we have got primary, secondary, tertiary, and then there's other bureaucracies. These are the current English bureaucracies, but you've got lender and hospitals, and you've probably got other sort of things. So they change from time to time. Now, you have to have bureaucracy. Bureaucracy is very important for linear tasks, like the fair and open employment of staff and the uncorrupt management of money. And anybody who works in a country without good bureaucracy knows how important bureaucracy is. But what we're doing is complex, and bureaucracy cannot manage complexity. So we call this 3D healthcare. So you become obsessed with the population subgroups. People with cancer, people with heart disease, people with more than one disease. 3D healthcare, we call it. And as I walk along the corridor there, I know it's in German, but I can see thorax and lung and heart. And it's a bit like this. Every country in the world, supermarkets are the same. Common stuff, beef, pork, lamb, and then a lot of rare conditions. Service line accounting. So we're changing all the budgets to service line accounting. You still have to have a budget for the hospital, but I would want to know, well, how much is spent in your land on musculoskeletal disease, and how does it compare with stereo? What's right? I don't know, but we mentioned discuss, because probably there'll be a twofold difference. But that's service line accounting, program budgeting. There's examples of that. So it's starting to shift the budgets to the third dimension. Number three is system design. Systems thinking is, of course, classic Toyota, but it's also classic biology. These are complex adaptive systems. Complex adaptive systems. So what is the system for doing something quite simple in Austria, like managing people with asthma? What is the aim? What are the objectives? Now, you see, what we've tried to do, if you take something quite simple like asthma, is try and make all these groups work better together. But what we need to do is to move to this. From this to this, like a Russian doll. And for some conditions, of course, inflammatory bowel disease, or cancer, or, you know, they're super specialists, but they have to fit in with self-care and informal care being part of the system. So what do you think, what does your respiratory department think about what education of the public or education of parents? Now, pediatrics has done this quite well, providing that people get to a specialist service. But we need to think in a different way. So here's what I did with some. Imagine you were all the respiratory physicians in Austria, asthma specialists. And I asked you to define the objectives of the asthma system. You'd probably come up with, well, what's missing from this list? Turn to your neighbor for a minute. What's missing? There's five objectives missing from this list. Turn to your neighbor for a minute and try to discuss this list. Asthma, you probably spend, what's the population of Austria? Eight. So you're probably spending 100 million a year in asthma, 120 million a year in asthma. So what are the objectives? What are the strategic objectives? Have a discussion with your neighbor. There's some important things missing here. These are all necessary, but there's some big things missing.
To support self-monitoring.
Say?
To support self-monitoring.
Yes, self-monitoring, okay. Yeah, but it's sort of, this is a little bit in there, yeah. Okay, let me show you. So remember, I've got here all the asthma, and I've got the patient asthma group in the room too. And the pharmacists and everything. And we've worked out there's 132 million euros a year being spent on asthma, and we haven't a clue what we're getting for it. So we want you guys, we're going to give you guys the budget. And here's the additional objectives. We want you, see these objectives here are just clinical objectives written for a population. But then you look at the bottom five there. So we want you to make the best use of resources. Okay, but it's not a direct. The finance colleagues are in the room, they'll help you with this. We want you to mitigate inequity. Well, I've never thought of that before. Okay, but you've got to think about it now. We want you to support research. In general, research improves the quality and value of healthcare. So we want you to support research. And we want you to support the development of staff. So if we think of Styria, for example, how many pharmacies are there in Styria? And what do the pharmacists know about asthma? Oh, well, they did it at university. Yeah, but you employ this person here who's terribly clever. And these pharmacies, they're just, you know, but they have a big important part to play in promoting self-care and doing things. And then this interesting one here, to report annually to the population served. So where is the report to the people of Austria on how we spent £132 million? And we may find that actually they're responsible for some things. They're not coming to the clinic regularly, or they haven't stopped smoking or whatever. So it's not just, they can't just blame us. We're all in it together. It's systems thinking. Systems thinking. Number four, deliver not through bureaucracies, but through networks. The 20th century was a century of bureaucracy. The Ford Motor Corporation, ICI, Kodak. 21st century is the century of the system and the network. Network theory. And of course, this is also part of what's creating networks. So I'm interested in, I think there are 15 hospitals in your land, but how many networks are there? Well, we haven't thought in that way before. But we're in England, we're getting them to think now much more in networks. And the network is the set of specialists and generalists working together. And we find they haven't actually changed much in 80 years, 100 years, because it's the bus routes. There comes a point where you stop referring to Oxford and you start referring to Reading. And you know, that goes way back, nothing to do with the politics of the jurisdictions. So thinking network theory. But that means we would want in every network there should be a clinical leader. So the clinical leader could be a family medicine, could be a pharmacist, could be a specialist, but they have to think of being a network, being a node in a network. What's the German for node? Nodes and networks. This is very fashionable, I can tell you. Network theory, terribly fashionable. Complex adaptive systems, much more complex than Toyota, run through networks. So that's a successful network does that. And then number five is individualized care. And just going back to the most important picture in healthcare, there's a very interesting clinical dimension of this, in that as you put more money into healthcare, you start to operate in people who are less affected. And as you operate in people who are less affected, the maximum possible benefit that those people can get will be less, but the probability and size of harm is constant. So we use words like higher value, lower value, zero value, but in clinical practice we talk about necessary, appropriate, inappropriate, and futile. And there's an increasing literature on futile care, you know, the ninth round of chemotherapy for someone who wanted a good death rather than staying alive. And I'm not saying you shouldn't have a ninth round of chemotherapy, but you have to be absolutely clear what you're offering. Quite often, how many anaesthetists are here? Yeah, quite often arguments between anaesthetists and surgeons. Oh yeah, I'll get them off the table all right. Oh, we want the operation. I've never done this operation before. Yeah. Okay, I'm getting off the table, but they're going to die 10 days later at ITU. Any ITU specialists here? A lot of ITU is taken up discussing with relatives. Oh, you must admit my mother to ITU. And most doctors want to stay away from ITU. Because, you know, it's right for certain types of condition, but quite a bit of your life, I'm sure, is discussing with relatives and maybe other clinicians about. Okay, so here are the implications. Just to finish, here's a couple of questions for you. Are you in the real estate business or the knowledge business? And do you feel accountable only for the quality of the service you deliver to the people who turn up, or accountable for the improvement in health and well-being for the people in need in the population you serve? Here are the five things. And these are sort of questions that we're asking in England, and we can't answer them yet. But you could take out the English cities and or regions and put in the lender. And then, you know, within London or within Birmingham, in big populations, we're asking these types of questions. So how many networks are there for people in the end of life in London? And which is best? And this one here, you know, is the service for people with rheumatoid arthritis in Oxford better value than the service in Cambridge? 47 years ago when I went to Oxford, we could not answer this question. Today, after 27 year organizations, I still can't answer this question. I can tell what happens in the rheumatoid arthritis clinic, I can tell what they're prescribing. I do not know whether it is better in Oxford or Cambridge, but I will before I finish. So, that is the future as I see it, and there are inevitable forces on this, and if we want to make sure universal health coverage is sustainable, we need to think a different way. And the key issue is culture change. And that is the key response to your leadership. And all I've done is make your job a little bit more complex, but I hope better fun. Thank you very much.